Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to start with computer graphics and visualization with our very most first topic, that is introduction to OpenGL. And we all of us know that computer graphics, just to learn the concept is not enough. We should know how to design the programs by giving some of the effects, okay? So how we are going to run the computer graphics program, we should have the basic knowledge of OpenGL, okay? So today, it will take for me hardly two more classes to explain the in detail about your OpenGL. So today we are going to start the basic things about the OpenGL. What is the meaning of that? How we are going to utilize this, okay? So if you will understand little bit, at least you can start with your programs, because how the VTU syllabus has been designed, it is very if I will go along with the theory module wise, then it is quite difficult to finish, to start with your computer graphics lab. So I should go according to the lab wise. So whatever the first module of your computer graphics says, everything is a basic about your computers and also the introduction part of your OpenGL, and there will be two algorithms, okay? So this is the first part of your modules, module one. And this is the whole and soul everything about your first module. So in your first part, it says about the computer systems and all. So that part I have not started. I have directly started with your introduction to OpenGL, because simultaneously we have to start with our lab programs. So we cannot move directly to the first lab program also. So here first we have to start with some basic lab program, some basic small programs where we are going to have the basic commands where we can utilize all the basic commands, okay? So that is the reason I'm going to start with our OpenGL. So moving towards the first slide, here you can see what is the meaning of your OpenGL. The first Viva question every time they used to ask you that, what is the full form of OpenGL? So I request everyone that you should maintain the running notes while whenever I'm explaining all the concepts, please write it down with me, okay? So here, what is the first question? It comes the full form of your OpenGL. So here you can see the full form of your OpenGL is Open Graphics Library, okay? So that is the full form of your OpenGL. One more thing also used to happen, like the Viva question, they used to ask you that what is the full form of your API? So that is your application programming interface. Many of you already know this, I know, but some of you maybe they don't know, let them to write it down. So API full form is application programming interface. So here, what is the meaning of your OpenGL and how the OpenGL is going to work out? So first thing is, if someone will ask you the question, what is OpenGL? You have to answer that OpenGL is a application programming interface. It means that it is a API, okay? And also, where we are going to utilize all this? We are going to utilize this for rendering the 2D and 3D vector graphics. So now, here you can see that it is the OpenGL is an application programming interface, and this is used for rendering 2D and 3D vector graphics. Now you can ask me, what do you mean by rendering? Rendering in the sense the movement of any of the objects, okay? Whenever we will move some of the objects, if you are holding your pen currently, so if you just try to move your pen, so whatever axis it's taking, it can be your 2. If you are placing that pen in 2D axis, it will be a rendering of your 2D vectors, okay? If you are putting your pen in 3D axis, then it will be a rendering of your 3D axis, okay? So in that way, we can render any of the objects in 2D or 3D vector graphics. Last class, we have seen that we have used some of the objects where I have shown you like rectangular, I have shown you the triangle. All these things we have placed in the Cartesian graph paper, right? So what happened there? You found some of the coordinate system. It can be, but whatever we have done, everything was in 2D because we have utilized only x-axis and we have utilized only in y-axis. We have not utilized z-axis. Suppose you just remember, I'll just write it down here also. Suppose one value has given 2, okay, comma 3. So now someone has told you that this is which axis, okay? You can say this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis. So the vector graphics will be 2D, right? This one will be vector graphics 2D. Suppose one Viva question they have asked you that convert this 2D vector graphics into 3D vector graphics. That time what you are going to do? We know that in 3D, we should have three axes. That is x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. But according to the question, they have given us only two axis points. That is 2 and 3. That is x-axis point and y-axis point. So z-axis is not there. But what you can do, you can put it as 0 and make it as your 3D vector graphics. Okay, I hope you have understood this part. In this way, you can convert your 2D vector graphics into 3D vector graphics. That is the first point. Second point, how we are going to interact with the graphics processing unit. So here, one more Viva question. The full form of your GPU. That is graphics processing unit. Why we are using this GPU? Because this OpenGL is a API, okay? That we learned in the first point. Now this API has to use or it can interact with this GPU. So indirectly we have the connectivity from OpenGL to GPU. So if you want to have, because this is a graphics library, right? Everything will be there in this library. So if you want to have the interactions, you have to connect it with your GPU, because this is known as your graphics processing unit. So if I will connect both the things through my API, then I can achieve all the renderings, or you can say, hardware accelerated rendering. You know, I have told you that just have a pen in your hand and just try to move it. So how I can move directly, I cannot do it. So if you want to write the code for that time, you should write in your program code the library functions, and also to call that you should have this graphic processing unit, or you can say that GPU. So by using both the things, you can render any of the object. Okay, that is the first two points. So now the next point says that if I will connect both the things, what all are the things I will get in my output screen? If you will connect all these things, okay, you are going to generate the color image, or you can say that you can generate any of the geometric images. Okay. Any of the things you are going to get it. Why I have called it as color image? Because this color image will composed of two things. The first thing can be your geometric. The second one can be your image primitives. So now what do you mean by geometric? Suppose I have drawn one square box, okay? So in my square box, that I will call it as, suppose that is my output. So I will call it as your color image, okay? So this color image also, I know that it is composed of two things. One will be your geometric and one will be your image primitives. So here what I'm going to do, the geometric in the sense that is a shape of your object. What is the shape of your object? It was a square box. The next one, the image primitives. Image primitives in the sense, what all are the functions or what all are the colors or what all are the outsider things you are going to give for a particular image, everything is known as your image primitives. Suppose I will tell you some examples. I have in the next slide many examples of your primitives. Remember, these primitives can have the vertex point. This primitive can have the color things. This primitive can have any of the things, whatever you are going to give for the image, any kind of your functions. Okay, so that is known as your image primitives. That is about your generating the outputs. Now, what is the last point you can see? It can demonstrate the OpenGL, okay, to write an interactive graphics program with some of the custom models of 3D objects. It means that whenever we are going to implement these OpenGL programs, that time it can give us any kind of your objects. Just now I have told you that it gave us the square, right? Similarly, it can give us the 2D object also. It can give us the 3D object also. But suppose if you want to give some extra features into that, you can go for your imaginary, you can go for your lightning theme, you can go for your texture mapping. All these things are your extra features which you are going to give for your 3D objects. Now, how you are going to give? For everything, we have the programs, okay? So that function name and primitives, everything you have to include in your computer graphics program. So accordingly, whatever you have, you will add, accordingly you will get your outputs, okay? So in your syllabus, the lightning, texture mapping, this is completely one more module. If I'm not wrong, it can be your module 4 or 5, okay? So by the time you will learn the before things and all, so that time it will be very easy for you to understand how to implement the lightning and texture things and all into your programs. Okay, so moving towards your next slide, here you can see, I have told you that the OpenGL, it is a API. Okay, so now here my first point says graphics rendering API. So what this graphics rendering API will do? Okay, so here the first point is, it will have, already I have discussed about this point, it will have the high quality of color images which will be composed with your geometric and image primitives, okay? And also you keep in your mind that in this, like this OpenGL, it is a graphics API only. It's not a platform of its own, okay? So it is also require some of the language, like it can be your C programming, it can be your C++ programming to operate. If it won't have the language, then it will not execute the programs, because we need to write the programs in C or C++, okay? But also it will have some of its graphics library functions which we need to include it. Fine. And one more thing is, here this OpenGL, it provides us many more things on your mathematics. So it can be your, like some mathematical like primitives are there. It can include your linear algebra, geometry, trigonometry, all these things. Okay, I will explain you all these things, how to utilize the like in the program code, how we are going to write all these things. I will explain you once the time comes. Okay, so don't think many of the things now. Currently, we are reading only about the OpenGL, how it supports and all, what all are the functionality will be there, okay? But remember, some of the functionality will not even require to understand in your mathematics, okay? Because already you knew from the beginning itself. So simply we have to utilize that primitives and we are going to see the outputs, okay? So don't worry for all that things. So here, the second point says that this graphics is a Windows system independent and also operating system independent. If you have in your laptop Windows, that also this graphics will support, graphics software will support. If you have Linux, that also it will support. If you have Ubuntu, that also it will support, okay? So no, don't worry for any of the operating system. It supports everything. That's the reason it's known as your like operating system independent. Fine. So now I have one more architecture here where you can see that this is known as your OpenGL architecture. So this OpenGL architecture can come for your some 5 to 6 marks of question, where you have to explain the this architecture in very detail. Okay, so here you can see the first one is the many points are here which we are going to utilize in our program. So that time that points clarity will get clear for you all. Okay, but now you can see that the first one we will have the CPU. Okay, so what is that CPU like? How it has been connected? This CPU will have some of the display list. Okay, so you just remember this OpenGL architecture. It's a very structured and state-based pipeline. Okay, it is a structured state-based pipeline because we have everything very genuinely here, so that we can follow all the process very minutely. So whatever the commands we are going to enter with this pipeline, it has to start from one end and it follows up into the another end. Okay, so we have the first thing is as we have the commands of display list. So here what will happen is whatever the commands we are giving, everything will get accumulated inside your display list. Fine. Then it is going to process. You can see from CPU to display list. Don't try to by heart this OpenGL architecture. It's not at all necessary. Try to understand how it has been followed up. Okay. The first thing is you should have the CPU. You know the system is having the CPU. So here you have the CPU which has been connected directly with your display list. What is the work of your display list? It will accumulate all the commands, whatever we are processing. Okay. And also you can remember whenever any process comes, it comes through your pipeline. That is the reason I told you that this architecture is a state-based pipeline. Okay. So first thing is whenever any of the commands will come, it will get processed and it will be inside your pipeline. Next, this display list, what it will do is it will allow, first thing is the it will allow only for the greater optimization things, which will have the more optimization things and the commands which can be reused, that things and all, first it will allow. Okay, so where it is going to allow, it can allow to this side also, it can allow to this side also. You can see my screen. Okay, so but all the commands, whatever the rest of the commands will be there, which we are not going to reuse, everything can be inside your display list. But first we are going to process the more optimized commands. Then we will utilize the less optimized commands. Fine. So then we will have here one more evaluator that is known as your polynomial evaluator. So what is the work of your polynomial evaluator? Here, what it will, as you can see the name polynomial evaluator, then definitely it is going to evaluate something, right? What it is going to evaluate, just imagine, whenever we are going to send any of the commands, so what kind of commands we can send? We can send the commands like 2, 3, in before 2, 2, 3, just I'll write down just to understand. Suppose I have written point, okay, P in the bracket, I have sent the command like 2, 3. So this is my command, right? So what I will do, I understood that this 2, 3, I am using for triangle also, I'm using for square also, I'm using for rectangular also, like this. So it will have the more optimization power. So first of what I will do, I'll just forward this command towards my polynomial evaluator. So what it will evaluate, what I have, I told you that we have one vortex point. Okay, and we will have some attributes. Attributes in the sense the functions of your commands, whatever we have given. So here it says that as it's suggesting the point, we have to draw the point, right? So here it will evaluate all the commands which corresponds to your vortex point and also with your attributes, whatever has been given. So that is known as your polynomial evaluator. Okay, I hope you have understood. If you have not understood, just note down your doubts so that again I can clarify your doubts. Fine. Next part is your, when I come towards here, you can see my pixel operations. So now, what do you mean by this pixel operations? Here, what will happen is, okay, before coming to this, I'll just go here, okay, as it is connected towards your polynomial evaluator. This is your per vertex operations and primitive assembly. So now, what it will do in this per vertex operations and primitive assembly? Here, it will include all the primitives, okay? What kind of primitives? The primitives can be your transformations. The primitives can be your lightning, clipping, projections, and some of the your viewport mapping, okay? So what is that? That things also, you don't worry. Each of the words are having one topic. Okay, so clipping in the sense, suppose if I have a line segment, I want to clip it. I have to apply the algorithm and I'm going to clip it. So clipping is again a different topic, which where you have the lab program also. So that kind of work, if you want to do, you have to go for your this section, that is your per vertex operations and primitive assembly. Okay. And also here you will have the lightning things. If you want to give some of the lightning effects towards your output, if you have drawn one couplet, okay? So if you want to give the lightning effect towards the cup or towards the plate, that also you can give by utilizing this stage, okay? So we have many operations and assemblies, sorry, primitives, which we are going to utilize in this section, okay? So now, next, it has been connected to my rasterization. So I will let you know what is this rasterization. Rasterization in the sense, we will have some, see, I'll just draw this also for you. Now you see what I'm writing. I have written here A, okay? Can you see my A is properly lined up, right? But sometimes what will happen in your output screen, I'm just trying to draw it for you all. You can see now. See how my A has come. It is having some of the more vortex point. One, two, I'll just change the color. One, two. Here you can see only one, two, three, four, five. Five vortex point. So if this A, I will make it as rasterized, how it will look like? It looks like this. It will have multiple vortex points, okay? One, two, three, here also four, here also 5, 6, 7, 8, then 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, here also 16, 17. So what it happened? It has been rasterized. So the rasterized image looks like this only, okay? So that you have to remember. So rasterization is nothing but where it will produce some of the fragments, or you can say some of the breakups. Okay, so that kind of things it will be having. And also it will have the series of frame buffer addresses. Now, what do you mean by this frame buffer? It is again a topic of your frame buffers. So what is that frame buffer? It will have some values, okay? Regarding that, you don't worry, that I have to take one example also. I'll explain you. So normally this frame buffer will have some of the addresses and all. Okay, and what it will have? It will have the address and the values. Where it will get? It will get from your viewport primitive. Okay, now what do you mean by viewport? That is also one more topic. Everything used to be overlap. You have to understand slowly, don't worry. Viewport in the sense, whatever view in the sense, whatever we are seeing, right? So now if I'm seeing something in my laptop, so that is my view. I can say it can be a horizontal view, it can be a vertical view, it can be a projectional view, it can be your orthographical view. So that is variety of views are there. So here, this frame buffer will have the views, okay? Like some of the values, it will get these values from your viewport. Why we are calling it as port? You know, port means address, okay? So if I am getting the view from my horizontal, then definitely it will have the address of my horizontal view. So that is the reason it called as your viewport, okay? Are you getting my in point? So what it will be? It will be like your viewport, okay? Port, P-O-R-T. So don't get confused with that. It will be like your viewport. Okay, I'm fine with this letter. Okay, viewport. Okay, so now next thing is, so some of the images we'll have whenever we are downloading, all the images can be in your bitmap or in your pixels, right? So that is also can be your input value for your frame buffer. So that is the meaning of your frame buffer. Fine. So now the next part is per fragment operations. Here, what is next thing where it has been connected? Per fragment operations. Here, what happens is, here before everything, whatever it will get rasterized here, it will be like I told, no, like how I have shown you the A, it has been rasterized, it has been like fragmented wise, and it has been sent to your frame buffers. Now frame buffer can visualize that break of things and can understand that, okay, it has to be modified or it has to be blended. So if I want to blended it up, I should apply some of the algorithms. We have one algorithm named as Z buffer algorithm. Okay. So this is my Z buffer algorithm. So whenever if I want to use my Z buffer algorithm, I should go for my this thing, frame buffer things. Okay. So that is the whatever we are going to do in the per fragment, we are going to send it to my frame buffer. Next, the last part, what will happen is, here we will have some pixel operations. By seeing all the pixel operations, how to do and all, by seeing the rasterized things, we are going to operate on that. And here, if you want to keep that texture in the memory, that also you can keep it, okay? If you want to keep any textures in your memory, then texture memory field will be there where we are going to save it. So this is all about your OpenGL architecture. Remember, this question can come for your 5 marks, okay? Not even 5 marks, it can come for your 7 marks itself. So where you are going to explain all the things in detail and you are going to write the answers, okay? So for today's class, I will stop over here. In the next class, we are going to continue this OpenGL things, okay? Hope you people have understood this. If you have not understood, you please note it to me that which part of the things you have not understood so that I can explain it once again. Thank you.